students, how are you? I am Francis sir, and today we are going to study class 7 history. Okay, so we studied this chapter in the previous lecture also, the lesson before the Mughal Empire. Today we will be dealing with the administration of the Mughals. We will be dealing with the administration of the Mughal Empire. Okay, so the kings who belong to this empire, what type of administration system they used to follow, we will be dealing with that. Okay, so at first we should see that the Mughal administration was divided into three parts: the central administration, the provincial administration, and the army administration. Okay, as you can see in the present time also, that we have two governments, one working at the center and the one working at the state. So the same type of administration was used in those days also. There used to be a central administration and provincial administration, and the army administration also was there in separate. Okay, so let's first go through a little bit of central administration. So in the central administration, the king was the supreme authority. His decision and his words were the final words. He was the supreme authority. Nobody could cross the king. Okay. And he was assisted in his work by a council of ministers. Okay, there was a council of ministers. As in the present time also, we have the cabinet ministry. They all have different portfolios and they work according to the post provided to them. The same idea was used that time also. So this king was assisted by the council of ministers. The most important of the ministers were the vizier. The vizier can be also known as the current finance minister. Okay, so this vizier was the finance minister of the time. Okay, he used to take all the financial decisions for the whole empire. Okay, what way the taxes should be, or how the budget used to be made. Any government works on a certain amount of budget. So that whole thing was finalized by this finance minister. Okay, then we have Sadar Us Sadur. Okay, he was the chief advisor of the king. He was the chief advisor of the king, and also this chief advisor in especially in the case of religious matters. Okay, he was the chief advisor in the religious matters. Also, if this king was absent during some time, he used to be. He could also act as the chief judge, or you can say the chief justice. Okay, so after the king, the chief justice role would be played by this Sardar Us Sadur. Okay, then the third important post was your Mir Bakshi. Okay, so Mir Bakshi was a very important person because he was the one who used to administer the army. All the works regarding and decisions regarding the army were taken by Mir Bakshi. Okay, then we have one more minister. He was called Khan-e-Saman. This royal families, they had very luxurious life in those times. Okay, and it required a quite good amount of raw material, finished goods, everything was required for so many members who were there in the royal family. Okay, so to maintain all this, it was a troublesome job, such a troublesome job that the king had to appoint a minister to look after the household requirement and needs of the royal house. Okay, understood? So these were some of the important council of ministers who were there in the central administration. Now we will go towards the provincial administration. As you know that if the empire is quite big, it is not easy for each the king or the council of ministers to go through the whole of the country and to solve out the problems or to correct the taxes or to do the development works. This all was not possible. This all was not possible. If it is so, then to be relieved of that type of burden, the whole of the empire was divided into subas. You can understand just like the present states, okay? As we have the countries divided into states, similarly the empire was divided into subas, and the commander in chief of the suba was the subedar. Subedar was the governor of the suba. So he also had some of his assistants, okay, who used to help him do the function. And the most important one was the Diwan. Diwan was the revenue official. You should understand that any government runs only by, only if it has sufficient amount of money. If it gets a sufficient amount of money, then only it would be able to do the function correctly. But how is it possible that it gets the money? It is a very, very common thing that, you know, the rulers always take taxes from the people who are being ruled by them. For instance, for nowadays also, you know, your parents might be giving taxes, yes? Taxes to the government. You know, it is something about 30%, almost 30% of the whole of income they get. So, it's not necessary everybody has to pay taxes. There is a lower limit. So, the people who don't earn so much money, they need not pay the taxes. But the people, those who pay money above a certain limit, they could pay taxes. Means actually they have to pay taxes. Understood? So taxation was a very important system to run the whole of the empire. So this Diwan, you know, this Diwan was a revenue officer and he used to collect taxes and all. Okay. Then the subas were further divided into sardars and parganas. Means, you know, as the states are further divided into districts, yes, and blocks, and so in the same way, this whole of the suba was again divided into sardars. Okay, so this was about provincial administration. Okay, now we move on to the army administration. In the army administration, the king was the supreme commander of the army. Yes, he was the supreme commander of the army. Yes. In the absence of the king, Veer Bakshi was the next in command. Who was the next in command in the absence of king? Means if the king does not have any time to take any decision, or he was absent, is absent at the time, any decision has to be made. So who could take that decision? It was only under the command of, and under the power of Veer Bakshi. So Veer Bakshi, as we saw, you know, it was very important. He was the administration in charge of the army. So after the king, the only in charge of the army was your main function. So these were some of the important aspects of the Mughal administration. But you should always try to understand how does an administration work. As I discussed a few minutes back, a government can only run if it has money, and money is always received through taxation. Nobody is going to give you your money for free. But only if they accept you as a ruler, they can give you a part of it. Therefore, though there was taxation system in the Mughal administration, there was some faults. You know, the people were a bit not happy. They were not happy with the taxation system. So one after another, you know, there were two. Generally, this was this Mansabdar system was in general methods of taxation system. But another was your Todarmas Manavaras. So one by one, we will be discussing this Mansabdar system and this Todarmas system. Okay. So let's go through the Mansabdar system. So what is the Mansabdar system? Mansabdar system, you know, the whole of the empire was divided into revenue circles called Mansab. Revenue circles called Mansab. And this revenue circle was headed by the Mansabdar. So Mansabdar had the control over the Mansab. Their, these Mansabdars rank was determined by the Zat. So Zat was a number given to the different Mansabdars, okay, according to the amount of tax they bring to for the empire. More the tax they bring for the empire, the more, you know, higher rank they used to get. Okay, so this Zat was number which represented the rank of the Mansabdar. Okay, so they perform both civil and military functions. So civil and military functions is they could also take control over the Mansab area. Yes, if there is any requirement of military work, you know, for example, a small revolt has been uprising, has risen. So what will happen? They can take their own army and try to control this revolution or revolt. Okay. So they were paid in the form of zakat. So these mansabdar, because of the duty they performed, they were paid in the form of jagir. They were paid in the form of jagir. Okay. So this was the case of the mansabdari system. So actually, this mansabdari system, this mansabdars, you know, they could collect taxes also. They could collect taxes. They used to administer as well as they could collect taxes also. Okay, in the particular area. Okay, but there were some faults. There were some faults. Okay, so means for instance, you know, there are three different places. One, there is a very fertile soil, and one, there is a poor soil, and one, you know, average, not so productive. At that time, the only occupation the most of the people had, means 95% of the population, used to do farming. So their only source of income was farming, and if they are placed in a fertile area, you know, they could get very good income because of they would have very good crops. But the farmers who were there in the poor fertile soil area, so what will happen? They won't be able to get so much of production in their crops, and they won't be able to so much nice taxes, you know. And so the land was different, but the taxation system was the same. So it was very difficult for the farmers to pay their taxes. So there was a condition of unrest in the common people that this empire, means the rulers of this empire, are not worthy enough to stay in this place. So one of the finance minister, one of the ministers of Akbar, Todarmal, he introduced what Todarmal's Bandobasti system. It has a very unique, means it was the same as Mansabdari, but there was a bit of modification. What he did? He went on for a survey for 10 years, 1570 to 1580. He surveyed the whole of empire. Okay, and in that, you know, he surveyed the what places, what type of production is there. Means higher yield crops is higher crops are produced, or less crops are produced. So according to the type of land, he marked the revenue areas. Okay, the fertile areas were marked differently, unfertile areas were marked differently, averagely fertile areas were marked differently, and accordingly they were told to pay taxes accordingly. According to the amount they produced, they were allowed to pay taxes. So this was a very good step by Akbar, by bringing about the Todarmal's Bandobasti system. So this brought the sense of respect among the citizens of that empire with regarding to the Mughal Empire. So this was our Mughal administration. So there are some drawbacks also. You will please go through the book, and if you get any problem, you know, you can give us a message, and we will sort it out. Okay. See you in the next video. Good day.